In our previous lectures, we have studied about direct and shear forces, and we assume that they are acting independently, and we analyze the stresses independently. However, in practical use, the loads are applied in different directions and they vary from point to point. So simultaneously, the stress developed varies from one point to another. So it also changes its nature from one point to another. Also, we have to sometime analyze the stresses on an area that is inclined with the forces. Hence, it is very important to analyze a small element inside the body. So when we consider a small element inside the body, it is acted by all the types of stresses, that is direct stresses and also the shear stresses. So these are all the types of stresses it has to undergo. So it is important to analyze the small element as such, and then we have to also find out the stresses on an inclined plane inside that element. So this chapter about compound stresses will take a combined effect of different type of stresses that act on a small element. For this purpose, we will choose a small element of cuboid shape, but otherwise you can choose the small element of any regular shape. So let's assume this is an element, and for the purpose of analysis, I will just cut it through a plane that is making angle theta with the vertical plane. So I will analyze the various type of stresses that are developed on this section AB when we have different type of, or you can say combined effect of, stresses. So for the purpose of simplicity, I just consider one part of the section. So this will give me a better view. So this is angle theta. So on this surface, I have to find the stresses normal to it and tangential to it. So with this change in theta, I will notice that my normal stress will change and shear stress will also change. For the analysis of compound stresses, we consider following cases. First is direct stress condition. In direct stress, we consider only the tensile or compressive stress in one direction. And second is biaxial stress condition. In this, we consider stresses either tensile or compressive in two directions. Third is pure shear stress condition. In pure shear stress condition, we consider that the element is under the action of only shear stresses. There is no tensile or compressive external forces. So now fourth is biaxial and शियर स्ट्रेस कंडीशन. सो इन दिस, इन एडिशन टू शियर स्ट्रेसेस, वी विल हैव कंप्रेसिव एंड टेंसाइल फोर्सेस इन टू डायरेक्शंस. सो इन दिस पर्टिकुलर लेक्चर आई विल एक्सप्लेन बायएक्सियल स्ट्रेस कंडीशन. दिस टॉपिक इज वेरी सिंपल. ओनली थिंग इज हाउ टू रिजॉल्व द फोर्सेस अलॉन्ग द सेक्शन एंड परपेंडिकुलर सेक्शन. वंस वी कंसिडर द इक्विलिब्रियम ऑफ द फोर्सेस, इट इज़ वेरी इजी टू रिजॉल्व द फोर्सेस एंड फाइंड आउट वेरियस स्ट्रेस इन डिफरेंट डायरेक्शंस. Now let's consider a biaxial stress condition in which a small element is acted by perpendicular stresses in x direction, let it be sigma x, it is tensile. We simply, if we are having compressive stress in place of tensile, we can just change the sign and it automatically, all the nelses will change accordingly, and sigma y in the y direction. So these are two perpendicular stresses that are acting on the element. So if we want to find out the stress on the inclined surface that is making an angle theta with the vertical plane, then we have to resolve all the forces in the direction normal to it and in the direction along, or you can say tangential to the surface. So let's consider, I transform this, I transform this figure to the cut section figure to give the clear image. So this is your angle theta, this is your surface, and in the direction perpendicular to this surface and along, there will be, you can say, normal stress that is perpendicular to this surface and tangential stress that is the shear stress along this surface. So now we will consider that the thickness of this section is 1 unit, so that all the areas that I consider will be simpler to calculate or simpler to explain. So for my convenience, I will take out a triangular prismatic element that is of the shape triangular prism. This point is T U. So the triangular prismatic element is P Q R S T U. So I just shift this to a two-dimension problem, so that we can consider it in a simpler manner, and I will consider the triangular face QU are for the analysis purpose. Because I considered the thickness as unity, I considered this triangular element of the dimension, that is the dimension dy, and here the dimensions are of ru side, it is dx. So now let's concentrate on this triangle. So we fixed thickness as one unit. Now on this triangle QUR, we have to consider all the forces that are acting on it. So in this direction we have the force sigma x into dy, that is stress into area, and area is dy into 1. So in this direction I have stress sigma y into dx into 1, and in the direction along which we want to find out the stress is sigma theta into ds into 1. Tau theta ds, so thickness is 1. So now I resolve all the forces so that we can equate them. So now this is the angle theta, and if I resolve sigma x dy in this direction theta, then this comes out to be sigma x dy cos theta, and in the direction of tau theta it comes out to be sigma x dy sine theta. Similarly, I will resolve this force in the direction theta and the perpendicular to it. So this is the angle theta. This will be sigma y dx cos theta, and perpendicular to it will be sigma y dx sine theta. Now let's make the equation by considering the body is in equilibrium. So in the direction of sigma theta, it is sigma theta, the forces are sigma theta ds, and that is this one. Opposite to this is this force, so it is minus sigma x dy cos theta, and another in this direction is this one. So this is again opposite to sigma theta direction, so it is sigma y dx sine theta. So this is equal to 0. So sigma theta is equal to sigma x dy by ds cos theta sigma y dx by dy sin theta. From this triangle I can easily make the relation of ds with dy. So ds is equal to dy by cos theta, and dx by sin theta. So when I put these in this equation, so I get sigma theta is equal to sigma x dy cos theta by dy by cos theta minus sigma y dx sin theta by dx by sin theta. So I get sigma theta as sigma x cos square theta plus sigma y sin square theta. So by using further trigonometry, I can say that sigma x 1 plus cos 2 theta by 2 plus sigma y 1 minus cos 2 theta by 2. So further simplifying, I get sigma x plus sigma y plus half sigma x minus sigma y cos 2 theta. So this is the final expression for sigma theta. If I further resolve the forces in the tangential direction to QR, so I get tau theta ds plus sigma x dy sin theta. That is, this term and this term, they are in same direction, and the opposite is this term. So I will get sigma y dx cos theta. So from here I get that tau theta is equal to minus sigma x dy sin theta by ds plus sigma y dx by ds cos theta. So this comes out to be, in a similar manner, I put the value of ds here as I did earlier. So it comes out to be minus sigma x sin theta cos theta plus sigma y sin theta cos theta. So this comes out to be minus sigma x sin theta cos theta. So this comes out to be 1 by 2 minus 1 by 2 sigma x minus sigma y sin 2 theta. So this minus symbol is telling me that the assumption that I considered in this direction is opposite to what it actually should be. So anyway, this doesn't matter. I keep it negative. So now we have equation 1 and another is tau theta minus 1 by 2 sigma x minus sigma y sin 2 theta, that is equation 2. So if I further analyze, the normal stress on the inclined plane varies between the value sigma x and sigma y as the angle theta is increasing from 0 to 90 degree. And also, if the case is that sigma x is equal to sigma y, so then sigma theta will be always is equal to sigma x or sigma y. And in that case, shear stress will be 0. And another thing in this particular analysis is that tau theta will always be zero for planes. That makes angle theta is equal to 0 degree or 90 degree. That means on horizontal plane and vertical planes, the value of tau will be zero, because you can see sine 0 is 0, and sine 2 times 90 means sine 180 is also 0. So tau theta is 0. And this is only for this particular case when we have biaxial stresses. And another case, we have to derive these things and we have to see. And tau theta will maximum and it will be at the planes that make angle of plus minus 45 degree. So these are various, you can say, important facts about this analysis. So no need to remember the things. Only thing is how you have to resolve the forces in the direction to get the value of, or you can say, to get the expression for normal stress and shear stress on a oblique plane.